I'm Josh Ryan. It's been a while, but I'm very excited to be back on set.
I'm Lance Phillips. We're going to have a fight to the death between Chris King, Kira Lyons, and Josh Ryan. That will be next week on The Gloves Are Off.
Well, I'm not going to be back on the show then.
Well, you will be. You'll be fighting to the death.
I'm just going to lose.
No touching of the hair or face.
Well, that's the thing. Kinger won't abide by those rules.
He'll totally
and
abide.
And Kira will just watch until one of us is tired out, and then she'll take out
he'll
the last person.
Absolutely abide by those rules. Hey, what's up? Gloves Are Off, Lance Phillips. Josh Ryan back on set.
Yes.
Good to be back, my man. Listen, there's some good football that's been happening in this area that we're going to talk to right off the bat.
Yeah, missed out on.
But first, we're going to kind of... Well, there's also some Raptors news that came down the pipe this week.
Yes, that's true.
More Colin Kaepernick news.
And the start of the NHL season, which I'm sure many people are excited
about.
Yeah,
kind of and a lot of interesting storylines to go along with
the
NHL season, right?
Like absolutely.
Ovi scoring dual hat tricks. Like
In two periods,
essentially. Yeah, it's incredible. First, let's hit the Wheatland Football League
to
begin with. And, of course... The Barons have basically run the table in the Wheatland Football League. They've gone undefeated all season, which means they're going to have home field advantage throughout the playoffs and into provincials. Josh Ryan, is there anybody at this point in the Wheatland Football League that can knock this team off?
I honestly don't think so. I think there's an outside chance
Sound like you are somewhat unsure about that comment.
Yeah, I think Holy Rosary is capable of beating them if the Barons have a really bad day. But the fact is, Garrett Musgrave...
They'd have to have a really bad day.
Yeah, Garrett Musgrave is too good a quarterback. He has too many other weapons around him, which we've talked about on the show at length. And their defense is much better than anyone, including the people at this table, gave them credit for at the beginning of the season.
Still a little susceptible, though, to that deep ball. That's been an issue that has plagued them most of the season. And we've seen it in the past. We saw it against Bonnyville. It cost them. It's something that they have to shore up, and they haven't done it yet.
But they also have this week to rest, prepare, and Garrett Musgrave, who we're going to have on the show later, we're going to ask him about why maybe the offense hasn't been quite as potent as it can be. I think this week off not only rests them, that gives them maybe a chance to work on a few things that could come into play in that final game, whoever they play, probably Holy Rosary.
Holy Rosary, and yeah, I mean, no offense to these other teams, but clearly Holy Rosary and the Barons are
the class of the
cream of the crop.
Yeah.
Okay. Bonnyville's there as well, but they're just not quite there. They just don't quite have the horses to compete with these two teams. And Holy Rosary's made strides over the course of the season. They've improved dramatically. I like what they've done by putting Chopper Hippie in an offensive situation. He's playing a back, essentially, now. So he's running the ball. He's catching the ball. He's doing all kinds of things. But they're not quite there. I mean, they're not quite at the Barons level. And the Barons have a ton of experience under the belt. They've got a lot of grade 12s that are excellent players. And it's the Barons' league to lose at this point.
It is. And you say that experience. To me, the main position that comes down to is Dante Tabaku versus Musgrave. That's such a big difference, I think.
I don't understand those comparisons because they're not playing each other. It's not like they're out there and Tabaku is playing linebacker to Garrett playing quarterback or vice versa. They're not playing each other. The teams are. Granted, they're comparable because they're quarterbacks, but it's an offense versus a defense.
I'm thinking the impact they have on their own teams. Garrett's such a calm and collected dude in general, not just as a player.
So is Tabaku. I'm not.
A year,
don't get
a year
me wrong.
Older.
I still believe it's the Barons. Okay. Barons league to lose, but you can't discount what's been done at Holy Rosary.
Fair enough. You had a great exhibition season so far for the Rustlers. Many different teams getting in action: volleyball, basketball, soccer. A couple of teams have gotten to play against youth sport teams, CIS teams, in certainly the women's basketball team, the men's and women's volleyball teams as well. But to mixed results, largely being beaten up badly. Some people think that doesn't bode well for the season or really help them this season. Do you agree with that, Lance? Do you think that properly prepares teams playing the season?
Okay, as it pertains to women's basketball, yeah, I think it's great. I think going in and getting absolutely stomped by a U sports team, and not just any U sports team, you're playing one of the best women's basketball teams in the country, basically, for U sports. I don't have a problem with that. You're going to learn a lot of interesting things about your team. What I don't like, though, I don't like that the men's basketball team played an all-star team from Edmonton and handled them easily. Yeah. And then they matched up against Briarcrest with the outlook that they were hoping to beat them by 50 points because Nate did the same thing. I think you have to give yourself competition that is legitimate competition. And those men that came out of Edmonton, whilst a couple of them were good ballers, that's not competition. They had like eight guys, they were shorthanded, and some of those guys clearly aren't at the level that some of the wrestlers guys are. And that's an issue. You have to play teams that give you that are very competitive. And the fact that you're hoping to beat a team by 50 is not good enough. That's not going to cut it. You have to play teams you're hoping you can just beat. And that's, you know, what Lakeland women did. They went into use to Regina and got crushed. And they knew they were going to, but at least they played against a team that was extremely competitive.
I do agree. I think without other games, they fortunately have had games against Sate, against other teams in the league, but without those games, I don't think that game against Regina is as valuable as it would have been, simply because you don't get to see your team in a real good situation on offense because they're basically playing defense most of the game, and it's a different level of pace.
But you're going to learn mentally what your players are.
I still find you need that enough repetition against comparable competition. So they've had some, unfortunately they've had that against games against Sate and others that are, you know, relatively similar on level.
Fair enough. Cam Newton is in the news, and not for his good football play.
No.
That's been few and far between this football season. However, during Wednesday's press conference, he made mention to Jordan Rodriguez that he thought that her comment about Devin Funchess playing physical on Roots was funny because it was funny coming from a woman talking about Roots. Then he apologized. But not when the reporter confronted him. It was a day later when he was essentially pressured, in my mind, into giving this apology. And these types of apologies, we've seen them before, Josh.
Yes.
Are they genuine, or are these athletes having their hand forced, therefore they're giving these apologies because they have to?
I think we'll never really know if they're genuine because we've never seen a player have a legitimate apology in the moment. And as you said, you know, it's a day
isn't
later.
Isn't that enough if you can't issue an apology in the moment or even when you're confronted after the fact? Isn't that enough to say, yeah, they don't care?
And I think not only is that evidence enough, also the reaction from much of the people in the league and fans who have called into the league, that they're essentially had similar reactions to he did, which is surprising considering women have been in ESPN covering football, covering basketball for decades now. It's not like that should be a surprise.
Right. And I believe that there's lots of reporters, there's lots of anchors, there's lots of people out there working in media that some people don't know what they're talking about, quite frankly. And then there's others that maybe don't know what they're talking about, but they sure look like they do. And that goes for men and it goes for women. But women are they take the heat on this as opposed to men. And it's not right. The fact that he apologized after one of his sponsors, Danon Oikos Yogurt, pulled their contract with him, essentially pulled all advertising. 9 hours after that, he releases a video saying, oh, I'm sorry. That's not genuine. It's not genuine. He's not the first guy to do it. We've seen this all the time. These athletes are issuing apologies after their hand is forced on it. It's not genuine at all. And if I'm the person they're apologizing to, I'm thinking, yeah, that doesn't mean anything to me.
By the way, could he have not made a worse mistake than with that brand to say that thing?
Yeah,
the brand that largely markets to women in the first place.
Absolutely.
Total bonehead move. A few bonehead moves around in the NHL to start off this season, though it was ultimately, I think, Lance, a great first week of games. Lots of storylines to talk about, multiple hat tricks. Some of those bonehead moves, I would say, is the entire Winnipeg Jets roster. But let's start with you in terms of what was your favorite storyline so far, because there are a lot to pick from.
Well, there are a lot. And to me, the most compelling storyline we've seen so far is that the Toronto Maple Leafs have 15 goals in two games.
Yeah.
There's one other team that has that many goals, and it's the Chicago Blackhawks. And the Chicago Blackhawks have a few good players on their team. The next closest are the Capitals, if I'm not mistaken. The Capitals with 11, six of which have come from Ovechkin.
Yeah.
So, you know, that's not team scoring. The Leafs are getting team scoring all over the place, and they're going to be a good team. And I'm not sure that everyone has given them their due on how good they're going to be this year. They're going to be exceptionally good. They're definitely going to make the postseason, and they are going to make some noise once they reach that postseason.
Yeah, there doesn't look to be a team in their division either that's immediately going to challenge for them. Some people are saying Tampa Bay is the favorite, but Toronto has looked very impressive, as you said.
I mean, we're two games in here.
That's true. So it is a small sample size.
We talk about compelling storylines. It's kind of humorous in a way because we're two games in. Right?
But what I've been most promising for me and what's most captivating for me is just how much offense we're getting. As you said, plenty of team scoring and players scoring in bunches. I mean, four guys scoring in their season opener. That hasn't happened in exactly 100 years in the NHL, which is phenomenal. That's an amazing amount of offense in one burst. And then, as you said, Ovechkin to do it a second time. I think if that pace can at all keep up, that bodes well.
Well, if league. That pace can keep up, and it's not going to keep up.
I mean,
up.
For Ovechkin, no, but I just
it's
mean...
It's not going it to keep off. Up. Like, there's not going to be this many hat tricks that are happening no. day in and day out.
But if we can get more 4-4 games, 5-4 games, I think that bodes really well for the season and for NHL fans in general.
Yeah, I mean, that's what the NHL wants, right? They yeah. want high-scoring affairs. You don't want games ending 2-1, 1-0. No. That's not what you want. But so to get high-scoring games is fantastic. It's not. It's just not going to stay like that. It's not. But again, I'm going back to the Leafs. What they've done two games into the season is pretty impressive. And there's no real end in sight to what this team is capable of as we've seen in the first couple of games.
I think when we see Edmonton-Toronto play, it's going to be a lot of fireworks.
Well, and that's the Battle of Alberta. We didn't even talk about that. And that's
another
area. Yeah, that's going to be great. Toronto Raptors have signed on Norman Powell for 4 more years at roughly $42 million. Most people might think per year, but it's not per year. It is the NBA, but it's for the full contract.
Yeah.
Is this a good use of Toronto Raptors' money?
It's tough to say because you're basically saying...
It's tough to say. Is it a good use of money or no?
I'll give you an exact answer, which is yes, I think it's a good use of money. The reason being, and this is mostly from reading different people's view on the player and just watching his numbers grow over the past 2 years, is the guy's young, very athletic.
Dynamic.
Dynamic athlete. And very coachable, which that group likes. And he's already giving them production that are similar to players who are much more paid even now than he is, like Tim Hardaway Jr. in New York, who's making almost $20 million a year for similar production. If this guy can become a star within the next 3 years, which a lot of people in Toronto think he can, then not only would he be not overpaid, he would be underpaid for the current contract he's on now. So I think this is actually a great move from the Raptors. It doesn't put them way over the cap. And if he happens to be a bust, he's still young, so there's potential. Maybe they can trade him to the Nets, because the Nets will take anybody.
In the world of NBA contracts, this to me is a bargain.
Yeah.
He's going to get paid way under half of what Kyle Lowry is paid.
Yep.
Well under half. He makes a nice payroll increase. He's going to go up roughly $10 million a year.
Oh, for sure. For him, it's still a good deal.
But I think it's a bargain for the Raptors. And they're getting a player, as you mentioned. He's very athletic. He's dynamic. He's only going to improve. Mm-hmm. He's going to improve. And if to lock this kid up for 4 more years spells good things. And I like the. I think he's a better player, and I think he's more dynamic and will be more dynamic than a player like Kyle Lowry.
Yeah, and he comes off the bench right now as their sixth man. Another great sixth man in the league is Andre Iguodala out in the Golden
You're
State
not kidding.
Warriors. And although Iguodala is obviously more experienced, but Powell gives them a similar production to Iguodala. Iguodala makes $7-8 million more a year than he does. That's a pretty good deal if you're getting a similar player for $5-7 million yeah. less a year.
I mean, ultimately, he's still a little bit overpaid.
You could say that about the league.
Everybody.
General.
You could say that about, you know, Kyle Lowry making $28 million a year.
It's a little much.
Heavily overpaid, you know what I mean? But in the world of the current NBA,
it's not
this is
much.
A good deal for the Toronto Raptors.
It's not. Let's jump over now to the MLB. We're in the middle of the playoffs now. No Blue Jays, unfortunately, to root for. And some are wondering whether or not Canadian ratings will continue to stay at a certain level, considering, obviously, we're a bandwagon country when it comes to the Jays. And just how many pure baseball fans are there left now that many people are drawn away to the NHL, to the NBA? Do you think people will still watch the playoffs this year?
I think it's fascinating about what you just said about a bandwagon country. Because to some degree, I agree with this, but... To some degree, I don't, and we don't have the metrics on this, so
we don't
really
have the exact metrics
know,
right now.
But it certainly feels that way when you look at attendance figures from the Blue Jays, and I know I've kind of skipped your question.
Answer
to your question is, I believe, as you mentioned, the purists are watching baseball, because the Major League Baseball playoffs are spectacular. They are incredible to watch. We're already seeing that. I mean, the Cleveland Indians' comeback victory against the New York Yankees was unbelievable. But as it pertains to Canadians, yeah, purists are definitely watching it. I mean, I'm watching it because I just love the sport of baseball. And I think a lot of people like that. You're going to see Jays fans that are bandwagon Jays fans. They're going to watch it. And a lot of them are probably going to watch because of Edwin Encarnacion playing for the Cleveland Indians. I think there's a lot of people that are watching. And if they're not, they should be, because it's fantastic ball.
I think that last one is interesting. You said the Edwin Encarnacion fans, because apparently there's a lot of angst over whether or not you should root for a guy who played for your team or not. I think personally, yeah, you should. He was great Blue Jay. He didn't leave on really bad terms or anything like that.
No, he totally didn't.
And ultimately, as you said, the playoffs have been good so far. Me speaking as I only became a baseball fan, or a Jays fan at least, you know, a couple of years ago. I certainly wasn't as interested to get into the playoffs this year, personally speaking. But when the playoffs get into the last couple of rounds, I don't think I'll be
they're
able to turn away.
They're good throughout. It's not just the last couple of rounds. They're just good throughout. There's always, I don't know how it happens, but there's always compelling storylines all throughout the playoffs. And there's games that you're like, this game is over, and it's far from over.
There's still things to compete for my attention, though, like local football, like the CFL. There's enough things now competing for attention that I think hurts the MLB just a little bit.
Oh my gosh! For anyone who watches Major League Baseball playoffs,
I don't doubt it.
There's so much great things, so many great things that happen over the course of the playoffs that you think, where was this in the regular season?
That's fair. That's absolutely fair.
Coming up on the other side, it's Albert. He is hanging out with us in the desk, full again.
That's also fair.
It's pretty hungover too.
Yeah, pretty much.
Thanksgiving.
Well, it was Thanksgiving.
Pounded the crap out of him for sure.
We're back and the gloves are still off.
Welcome back to The Gloves Are Off. I'm Josh, he's Lance, and we're joined by a very stuffed bird. Usually they're not stuffed after Thanksgiving, but in this particular case.
This guy escaped the oven.
He did.
He
escaped it on a very full stomach.
Yeah.
You've got
do you want
mail.
To start? Do you want me to start today?
You, please.
Okay.
I will start.
I will start on the first tweet of the day from a very, as I said, stuffed bird. And one of your favorite Twitter handles, the Vegas Golden Knights.
Yeah, some stuff is good, some stuff is really corny.
Oh, so they've fallen off a bit?
No, they've had some really hot stuff, like really hot stuff. And then they've had some other stuff that's hot garbage.
Fair enough.
People find it funny, I think, just because they want to, but yeah, it's mediocre.
Okay, so they've definitely not on the hot streak they started on, I guess, when they came out. Here it says, I'm really excited to join the Golden Knights, but I just have to find out who I am as a person first. 2018 sixth round pick.
Yeah, I mean, this is one of those ones where I'm like, it's okay. You know, it's okay. Some people
it's
think
not
that,
one of their best work. It's
still
kind of laugh.
It's all right. Okay. But they've had some really good ones. Like, they've had some of the ones about, you know, like opposing teams line up and they're playing the Sharks. It's like just a bunch of Sharks, like shark. Like, those ones are pretty good.
Maybe it's just hard to keep up the steam when you're doing it every
day. Yeah, for sure.
Yeah.
Jeopardy Sports. This MLB team's postseason appearance lasted less time than it took you to read this clue.
I'm guessing that was the Twins, right?
That was the Twins. Yep. But it's a one-game wild card game. And what do you expect?
And it wasn't like they were that competitive in that game either.
They're not the only team. No. Like, talking like they're the only team.
Wild card games are actually some of my favorite postseason games.
For sure they
are.
These are great.
From at the Argos Oars, nothing but respect for the CFL family. When one mourns, we all mourn. R.I.P. Barry, and that's referring to a tie cat, Barry Corey, who passed away recently. That was also given to them by at @Mike_Cluett. So really classy move, I think.
So the Argos Oars are a fan group, essentially, you know, that follow the Argos.
Yes.
You know, and the Argos and other teams have these throughout the league. It's not new.
And they've made an appearance on the show before as well.
Right. The Argos Oars, this is their kind of their mantra. They're all about inclusivity. They're all about, you know, the CFL banding together, and there's other groups within the Argos fandom area that aren't quite the same. You know, they're all about, you know, exclusivity. You know, other fans from other teams come into BMO Field, and
Mail
you know
in
they're
the beach.
They're chanting it, trying to get them out, and that's not the way to handle it. So the Argos Oars have it figured out.
In this particular case as well, I think they handled that very nicely.
Yeah, of course. Rob Perez at Worldwide Wob. I think that's pretty clever, actually.
Yeah.
I know you're new here, but I play point guard, not pass guard. That is going to be one word to describe that relationship.
Contentious.
Pardon?
Contentious.
I was going to say tumultuous.
That's a pretty good word, too.
Same thing. Basically, I can't wait to watch this develop over the course of a season, right?
I love how it basically took 2 days of practicing, and we already have unhappy Hoodie Mellow.
Yeah, for sure.
With the Oklahoma City Thunder. This is from at Lance Phillips TV.
What?
Uh-oh. Somebody forgot something. Hashtag, where those are going.
Those are news anchor Nicole Stilger's stiletto heels that are broken. And I have been, the heel's broken on them. They look like they've been chewed by a dog. And I've been all over her for weeks to get rid of them. Like, and every day I'll be like, hey, can I throw those shoes out?
And sure enough.
Yeah, so Nicole's last day was Friday.
Yeah.
And she left them behind. And they're still under her desk. And I'm not sure what I should do with them. I think, you know, someone wants to tweet in an idea at Gloves TV.
Yes, please.
Send us in an idea. Or you can hit us on Facebook, The Gloves New Cap. Get us an idea as what we should do with these shoes. I was actually going to bring them on the set, but then, you know, keeps my fond memory of Stilger with us.
Our biggest Pats fan in the city is gone now.
Craig Fraser at Fraser0308. Chicago defeats Pittsburgh 10-1. That was ugly. People freaking out saying Sid has a self-portrait in his attic that's slowly turning into McDavid. Oh, hashtag NHL, hashtag McPortrait.
Yeah, Craig Fraser, buddy of mine, actually met that guy in school, and that's, yeah. It's
a, that was clever.
You've got creepy, nailed.
Yeah, no, creepy for sure. Photo, too.
Yeah, right? Definitely. Like but, Adam's family-ish.
I mean, that's also going to happen with McDavid, obviously. Just going to take a quick look at two different tweets here. The first one, this is from at W0ULD, Ryan Wold. Jeremy Lin out there roasting Kmart. So much respects, I don't know how to feel. So Kenyon taking a shot at Jeremy Lin's hair, saying that your last name is Lin. Why are you doing this? Jeremy Lin's response,
just gold.
Pretty classy. Hey, man, it's all good. You don't have to like my hair and definitely entitled to your opinion. I legit grateful you sharing it, by the way, because I have dreads and you have Chinese tattoos because I think it's a sign of respect. I think as minorities, the more we appreciate each other's cultures, the more we influence mainstream society. Had your poster on my up on my wall growing up.
That's the most non-NBA response ever.
Yeah, that's 100% true.
And what's amazing about it is he roasted him about having Chinese tattoos. He roasted him, but sounded super respectful.
Yeah, sounded super nice while doing
You've got mail.
What a nice guy that Jeremy
Lin is. Yeah, Jeremy Lin's, I mean, he's a pretty good guy in general. Lin Sanity, okay. Hashtag Lin Sanity.
This is pure gold.
Oh, yeah.
This is Greg Wyshynski.
I know what this
is. At Wyshynski. That picture is Nick Ehlers and Patrick Laine of the Winnipeg Jets. And Ehlers and Laine are those thugs trailing Jason Bourne back to his apartment before he kills them both with magazines. Like, why? Someone needs to send that into what he looks like.
Yeah, that's exactly. What he looks like is, like, trending all over U.S. now, it feels like.
Send that. Josh, I'm leaving that up to you because what he looks like is your big follow. So
that's true.
Send that into them and say, guys, this is pure
gold.
Hey,
there's it is. Mail.
Also send that into at Lebatard Show. I'm sure they get amazing a good laugh stuff at that. Yeah, great stuff. Speaking of amazing, at The Onion, one of our favorites, NHL warns hockey fans that banging on the glass scares players.
Yeah, that's it's amazing, right? Like. Onion is gold.
Yeah.
And even in the wake of the Vegas shooting,
shootings,
this is more than one person was shot,
yeah.
They're witty, but they still paid respect and still did the right thing.
Yeah. Which is not Onion, an easy to do thing with comedy. It's
nearly
not
impossible.
Easy.
Like, just steer clear of that stuff,
usually.
Right? Like, steer clear of that stuff.
Yeah, very tough.
Pete Blackburn, I love Pete Blackburn. He's unemployed currently, but he's still a good sports guy. Mm-hmm. After Labor Day, Patriots bending the rules again. Of course, that's the Patriots wearing all white. And
I guess those headlines just fall
mail.
Together, okay?
Yeah. All right, we got time for one more quick.
Last one, okay. Back to The Onion. Tom Brady applies eye black to crow's feet.
Yeah, like, how good is that? Honestly, how good is that?
I love The Onion sometimes, man.
Coming up on the other side, Garrett Musgrave joining us in the studio in a chat with him.
We're back. You can keep your gloves on, but ours are off.
Welcome back. Garrett Musgrave joined us for round number two. You came back for a second time,
back,
eh?
Thank you. It's good to be back.
Is it? Mm-hmm. Really?
Jeez, yeah,
I love hearing that kind of
that's
thing.
That's a good response.
Listen, big news. So you're wearing the Barron's Pride t-shirt there.
Yeah.
But you're also wearing something else. You're wearing Alberta Golden Bears hat.
Yeah.
What's the significance of that hat?
I signed with them. I'm super excited to be going to the University of Alberta, and it's just another chapter in the book.
That's awesome. What you were also looking in Calgary, correct?
Yes.
So what made you make the decision that you wanted to go to Edmonton?
I loved Coach Morris. I love the atmosphere that he has on his team, how he runs his program, and it's close to home, and the schooling is great there, and that's really what got me. I want to get a good education out of it and still have fun playing football.
Yeah, and you kind of said off camera, you liked the atmosphere of when you were there. Tell us about that.
It just felt like a big family there. They were all super close, laughing,
cool.
But they're there to work also. And yeah, no, I got to sit on some meetings, and I just loved how they address the players and how they bring their plays in and say, if you want to do this, just try it, and if it doesn't work, do this. And yeah, it was really, really good to sit in on those and see how it goes.
What was it like sitting in on those meetings with those players, given you're still playing with high school kids?
They're big.
I guess
they're
so.
They're huge.
Big
they're
boys.
Huge. But no, they were really good about it. They respected me. They treated me as I was one of them. And yeah, no, it was really good.
Yeah. What is the signing period? Is 2 years if I'm not mistaken?
It's a guaranteed 2-year.
That's awesome. But you mentioned that you're interested in football, obviously.
Yeah.
But that's not your primary concern going there, is it?
No, it's mainly school.
And what are you taking?
I'm going to apply into physical education and health sports performance.
And with the long-term goal of?
Kinesiologist.
That's awesome. That's such a great... It's such a great field to get into.
Yeah.
Like it's endless because sports is never going away.
Yeah.
You know, the human body will always require work. So that's amazing. On the football side though, you're treating it like a tryout.
Yeah.
You said, I asked you if you're trying out and you said, I'm not sure, but I'm treating it that way.
Mm-hmm.
That's the right mindset to take going in there for sure. What are your expectations when you think about it now?
I know I'm not going to be the guy when I get there for sure, but I'm going to go there and show them what I got, and if they move me around, they move me around. I'm there to play. I just want to go and have fun.
Yeah, now knowing that this is done, that you know where you're going to go to school, does that make going through the rest of this high school season a little easier, not having to think about that at all?
For sure. It makes me focus on school a little more because I know where I'm going. I know what I want to do. I know I got to get the grades to get in to play. So it makes me focus a little more on schooling. So I make sure I get into the school and can play football.
Facilities are a big thing for college athletes. I mean, if you take a look at Alabama as an example,
yeah.
Crimson Tide have the most unbelievable facility for their athletes.
Mm-hmm.
What were they like up at U of A?
I actually haven't really seen them, really. No, I went up there, I watched one or two games on the internet and went up and watched one in person, and then I signed with them. I got to go through the locker room and was on field with them. The locker room's really sweet. It's nice and close, so you get to meet everybody and be
close
with them. And yeah, no, it was great. I'm just waiting to get up there once the season's done on my official visit, and then we'll go from there.
When is the official visit? Sorry, Josh. When is the official visit?
I haven't booked it yet. No, I haven't.
Need to get on that, man.
Yeah, no, gotta finish the season first.
Yeah, speaking of that season, you guys have had a pretty good one so far. Mm-hmm. Undefeated in league play. Now you're just waiting your opponent for the next round. Tell us about the last game.
We started off pretty slow. It was not our best showing, but near the end we started to put pieces to the puzzle together and it slowly started to flow. But we got to start out faster, stronger, but every team has those games and we just got to use this bye week as a good bye week, and then next week comes and we're ready to go.
There's some bodies that need some healing. I know that your ground game didn't really get going against Bonneville like it did even up in Bonneville.
Mm-hmm.
Matt Moran was banged around a little bit. It'd be a good week for you to use it to heal up.
Obviously. Yeah, for sure.
How are you feeling?
I'm good.
I know you've had some
good
stuff yourself.
A little sore, but that happens to everybody. And we're all going to heal up, and next week comes, and we're going to be 100% ready to go.
How are the guys feeling about your bye week, or not your bye week, pardon me, about your next opponent, which more than likely is going to be Cold Lake?
We don't really know right now who we're going to play, so we're going to go in and just treat it as we're facing Holy Rosary every week. So we got to, well, right now it's if you lose, you're done. So we got to go in and win.
Yeah, and that was one of the most anticipated football games probably in the city in the last, you know, 5-10 years with how close you guys are this mm-hmm. year. How much fun was that to open the season that way, I guess?
It was a lot of fun. It was great to finally beat them in 6 years. That was pretty special. But no, it showed our team what we could really do and how we could really put our team together fully. And we just got to get back to playing like that with every team, which it'll come, but it'll take some time.
Is this the best Barons team that you've seen since you've
since
been
I've seen, with my 3 years, yeah, for sure.
What championship aspirations, obviously, you know, how do you feel about your chances of getting to that point?
Well, that's our goal. We don't really say we're going to make it or we're not going to make it. We're going to go day by day, and if we win it, we win it. If we don't, we don't. We got provincials no matter what. So
yeah, that's
great. Our goal is the provincial final, so we're going to shoot to that, but the Wheatland would be nice as well.
Yeah. And to get there, obviously, you're going to have to play the Raiders at least one more time.
Mm-hmm.
Last time we were on the show, we talked to both you and Chopper Hippie and talked about what it would be like for you two to play against each other. Was that a weird experience at all, or was that as fun as you guys thought it would be?
It was pretty fun. I found it fun, but on the field, we're not very good friends on it, but off the field, it's like normal. You just go have a normal conversation and we just talk about football when we hang out and do all that.
That's awesome.
So it was pretty fun.
What's been the most enjoyable aspect of this season for you?
Oh, geez. Just the whole atmosphere of the team. We're actually gluing together and coming together as a group, which is awesome. And it's a great atmosphere out there. We're all having fun. And I don't know, it's probably one of the best 3 years ever.
That's very cool.
Have you enjoyed the fact that you haven't had any really atrocious weather yet as well? I know that's sometimes,
yes.
that's sometimes
yeah.
a struggle in this city, right?
Yeah,
when you get later in the season.
Yeah, no, it's been nice. We've been blessed with great weather so far, and we're hoping it continues, even though it's snowing today, but we'll get through it.
Does it feel daunting when you think about what's still left to go for you guys? I mean, as far as you still have to get through Wheatland, you have to roll through provincials. Does that seem daunting at all when you think about it?
Not really. It's actually gone by pretty quick. Like it has
season short.
Yeah, it is very short, but it hasn't felt like we've played six games already, which is wild to think about. But it comes and goes really quick, so you got to make the most of it.
Yeah, we've talked a lot on the show about how good your ground game is as a quarterback, and you obviously haven't been able to use that as much when you were a little bit banged up. Has that been good in terms of it's forced you to use your arm more than normal, or just really rely on your arm?
I'm not too sure, really. Like, I try and run at least a little bit every game, but if that doesn't happen, I know our guys are there to catch, and it's been nice to throw and stay a little close to the ground. I guess.
Do you ever worry about your coach having heart problems on the sideline when you take off for a run at all?
No.
I know as a coach, I'd be like petrified watching that.
Yeah. No, I think he gets excited with everyone else when I take off, and I know it's fun. It's fun to go and hit people.
There's a lot of talent surrounding you. I mean, you have a ton of guys that can catch the ball. Mm-hmm. Those two running backs are incredible. Garrett Hatchard on defense is a special talent. What does it mean to your program to have a guy like that on defense, given his talent level?
It's huge. Our whole defense is fairly stable, I think, and it's not just one guy doing everything. Our D-line's great. Our backer core is incredible. Our halves are awesome. Everyone's pretty well-rounded, and they're glued together like the offense is starting to go, and they got a little jump start to it in the game, which was awesome. They held Bonneville, which we loved, and we just need to catch up to their speed.
Is that kind of, does that feel nice knowing that some people didn't necessarily think defense would be a strength of your guys' at the beginning of the season, and your defense has been as good as anybody's, basically?
Yeah, no, that's awesome to think, but we just, like I said, we need our offense just to catch up that little step, and then we'll be rolling pretty good.
What do you think, you mentioned about starting early and getting off of that good start. Is that a matter of pre-game preparation for your team, or is there something else that you need to focus on to get that sorted out?
It's just execution. We need to do what we need to do. I think a little bit of it is nerves. That
sure.
Some people are just giddy and they got to get the first couple plays out of the way, but I don't know what we can fix that.
Yeah.
But
is that a concern at all then, heading into the playoff round?
It's a little bit of a concern to me, yeah, but these couple of weeks coming, I think we'll try and fix it up, and then we should be fine to go.
I got to ask you, and this is fascinating to me, and I know across the U.S. this happens all the time, but when I went to high school and played high school ball, playing under lights was not a thing. There are no lights at the field that I went to high school at. The field is nothing like what you guys play on. It's got a ridge of dirt down the middle, basically, where grass is gone. What is it like for you as a young player to go out and play on that kind of field that's kept as well as it is, and to be able to go out there and play under lights with hundreds of fans watching you?
Awesome.
What is that feeling like?
It's awesome. You can never get any better feeling than that. Friday night lights with the crowd cheering, and you just march the field and score. It's pretty special.
Is it more challenging playing under those lights, you find, or is it easier for you? Just speaking from your position.
I don't really have a difference, really, if that makes sense. I don't know, I kind of get in my own little world when I'm out there. I just do what I want to do.
I know you haven't been to a game yet, but it's awesome to be on there and just watch games. Even from my standpoint, just watching them under the lights is very cool.
The lights are special games.
Yeah, for sure. They're amazing, and you're gonna have more of those this year, I'm assuming, before the season's out.
Yeah, we should.
Yeah.
We should. With
which
the
is
daylight.
Which is gonna be great.
And you mentioned just obviously having hundreds of people. How just how awesome is it that so many people have supported you guys this year?
It's awesome. It's really fun because we know that many more people are interested in Barron's football.
Right.
Like the previous years, there hasn't been as many. They're always over at Holy Rosary, but this year they're all starting to flow to the comp, which is awesome. We have lots of supporters, lots of fans, and it's fun to hear everyone talk about it during the week, and then as soon as the weekday comes, they're super excited and they just want to come out and watch.
And there's a lot of fans, I think, that aren't cheering for necessarily one team or the other.
Right.
They're just there to see some good football.
Yeah.
They're seeing good football, which is awesome.
For sure.
And the great thing for you guys is you have home field advantage basically the rest of the way here.
Yeah.
So you're going to get two more games for you win your next one.
And
at
provincials
home.
And
provincials as well.
Yeah.
So there's more advantage there. So I mean, you should expect even more people out of these games.
No, if the weather stays.
Yeah.
If the weather's warm.
Going off topic a little bit here, what was it like going up to Bonnyville and seeing the field and the facility they have up there now?
It was awesome. It was fun to play on. Usually kids in the Wheatland don't get to play on turf until provincials, but some don't even make it there. So for them to go out and play on a turf field under the lights, it was pretty special. It was fun.
Was that something you maybe hope to see in Lloydminster one day?
I'm hoping Lloyd gets turf. Yeah, no, that would be sweet.
Is it a more challenging field to play on as opposed to grass, or do you have a preference either way?
I like turf, personally. You get more grip with running, and I don't know, it just feels better, if that makes sense.
The comp needs to get, they're getting a 1,200-seat grandstand to finish that off. That's what they're getting. That's what the comp or the Rosary need to get, is a nice grandstand like that.
Mm-hmm.
Well, listen, man, good luck. Enjoy your bye week.
Thank you.
Rest up, get healthy, make sure your guys do that, and we'll be looking forward to seeing whoever it is you play next
out
of the comp field. Thanks for coming by again,
man.
Really appreciate it. Coming up on the other side is what, Josh? What are we doing?
We're thankful for many things this Thanksgiving.
Are we?
Yeah.
Something's bugging me, too.
Oh.
If you can't score, you might as well drop the gloves.
Garrett Musgrave, destined for good things.
Mm-hmm. Excellent. He's definitely going to be a guy to watch over the next couple of years at U of A.
I mean, he's a quality athlete. I mean, he can do a multitude of things. And we didn't even get into the fact of what he does on the ski hill.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, he's a ski crosser who won numerous awards this past winter ski crossing, has a chance to go train in Colorado, and so he does that on top of football, on top of all the athletics he does, all the other athletics he does, and he's a quality kid.
Yeah.
He's a quality kid.
And he understands how important academics is.
Yeah,
which I think
for sure.
Is really
and I feel
key.
Like a lot of, especially when you talk about football players, I mean,
you
know, you look no further than the U.S. and some of these reality, essentially documentaries that have come out about football programs, and kids have no desire for the academic side, right?
Absolutely.
All right, let's do, we're going to do winner, loser, but we're actually going to do winner turkey in honor of Thanksgiving that has recently passed.
Yeah.
So, Josh, why don't you start this one off?
I'll start this
one. Are you loaded with more turkeys, or are you loaded with more
losers? I usually have more losers, so absolutely I have more turkeys.
Yeah,
I can go
turkeys.
All turkeys if
you want.
Why
don't you start taking a positive approach to this segment, like me?
Well, I might get more positive later, but no, I'm going to start with turkeys. I'm going to stay in the negativity.
No, there is something oddly compelling about turkeys.
Yes, and in this particular turkey is the Winnipeg Jets. I know it's a small sample size, but their first two games of the season were a complete disaster, giving up 15 goals, only scoring 5 goals, and losing just in really bad fashion to the Leafs, then giving up 4 unanswered to lose to the Flames 6-3 on Saturday night. I mean, you have the best fan base in the league. I know the Toronto Maple Leafs are a great fan base, Edmonton, Calgary, there's all these great Canadian fan bases. The Jets have the best fan base. It's their team, and they have sold out that arena for the several years they've been in the league since, and to have that kind of effort, to have that kind of roster out there, to play that kind of defense, Paul Maurice will probably have his job on the line, unfairly or fairly, and certainly Kevin Sheveldayoff might have his job on the line. This team has been trying to be competitive this year. They've been building towards this year. I know it's a small sample, but that's an awful start.
It's bad.
It's really bad.
It's bad. I mean, we're 2 games in, so
I know
lots
it's
can
a, it's
happen,
a small
right?
sample size.
That's
but
the third time you said small sample size. I'm keeping
small
track.
Sample size.
That's 3. 1.
Small sample size.
3. 4,
small sample
5,
size.
6 times.
Size sample.
Listen, I also have a winner. Actually, that was a turkey you had, so I have a winner.
Okay.
My winner is the Bonnyville Voyageurs, for one reason, and that reason is Silas Fenya, who is their quarterback, and I'm pretty sure that's how you pronounce his last name, yep. is Fagnan.
I'll take your word for
F-A-G-N-A-N.
It. He
is an absolute stud at quarterback, and this team is lucky to have him. Not only are they lucky this year, they're going to be lucky next year as well,
yeah.
because he's only in grade 11. Last year's a grade 10. He broke school records that had been in the book since 1985. 32 years old. And I'll give you an example of some of those records. So, over the course of a season, passing yards, 1,520 passing yards he had, broke the record. Season, TD passes, 20 TD passes last year. 79 completions over the course of last season. And in a game, he had 5 touchdown passes, which was another record. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 records he broke last year. This kid is 17 years old. He was 16 at the time.
Wow.
The kid's an absolute stud. And the fact that they have him back can only spell good things
yeah.
for that program. And I believe that although Bonneville's not quite there this year and he hasn't quite had the weapons to throw to, give that kid another year. And the comp's going to be without Musgrave. Mind you, they have a pretty good backup in Anton Amandrud. But I think Bonneville is going to be a force to be reckoned with next year. I believe that they're going to have a good program.
I think that it'll be at least 3 very dominant teams competing for that Wheatland
right.
title next year.
Right,
it'll
exactly.
be fun to watch. So shall I wade back into negativity?
Please
okay.
do.
I have another turkey.
Gobble, gobble.
And that's Anthony Davis. You could call the Pelicans franchise as well a turkey, and you could call Boogie Cousins a turkey.
Why don't they just call them the turkeys?
I mean, actually, that would make more sense.
Right.
And that a mascot would be less terrifying than the current mascot
that's
they have.
True. That thing is terrifying.
But unfortunately for Davis, he had a great contract at the time, so he thought now he's stuck in this contract with a team that might be relocated possibly the way the NBA talks have been going with Boogie Cousins, who no one wants to play with Rajon Rondo, who no one wants to play with, and in a conference that's absolutely loaded with star power. Now the Warriors obviously the favorite to win expected, but you have a reloaded Houston team. The Spurs are always going to be good. This Thunder team, if this experiment works out, could be interesting. The Clippers, if healthy, could be really good. And now the Timberwolves and the Nuggets looking to push as well. The Pelicans are destined to miss the playoffs again, destined for a tumultuous season, as Lance
word.
Loves that word. And just another unhappy year for Anthony Davis.
Got a sick unibrow, though.
Well, if you call it sick, I call it a unibrow.
Sickly.
Okay,
sick
sickly.
Sickly unibrow.
Sickly is a better word for that unibrow than
when
sick.
When I say short form,
okay.
sickly.
Okay, okay.
Yeah.
I thought you were going somewhere else with that.
No. All right, I'm going to go turkey.
Oh, okay.
Yep.
Okay.
The turkey is Colin Kaepernick, but not because Colin Kaepernick's a turkey, but rather because Colin Kaepernick came out Sunday and said that he would now stand for the national anthem
right.
if he could get back into football. Just bring this guy back on. Don't make the guy have to go against what he believes in because you are a stubborn owner of a team and don't want to bring this guy on. Are you telling me that the Denver Broncos, who are currently using Trevor Siemian, couldn't benefit from having Colin Kaepernick in their
yeah.
lineup? Give me a break. Bring this guy in the league. Don't let him be a turkey anymore. If he wants to protest, let him protest. Other players are doing it. It's a movement. Bring him back.
You're telling me the New York Jets couldn't use Colin Kaepernick?
There's many teams. It's not just the New York Jets.
Jags.
There's lots of teams.
Blake Bortles
falls somewhere in like between like that white stuff that accumulates in the corner of your mouth and gum on the bottom of your shoe. Like he's useless. Totally useless.
That's really not a nice thing to say about that stuff between white stuff and gum on your shoe.
It's awful. It's useless stuff that's annoying, and that's what Blake Bortles is. He's terrible.
Yeah. Okay, we'll be slightly more positive
we'll
and then negative.
Yeah, and on what's bugging you.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We're back, and the gloves are still off.
What's bugging you? But Josh, first, you have something to be thankful for. I don't know what it is.
Yeah, I just thought since we just had Thanksgiving, we
right.
should, and I've been saying nothing but turkey so far, I should start with some positivity. So here goes. I'm thankful for the fact that we have hockey and season back and basketball season ultimately up and coming. It's a little tough in the winter here sometimes because, you know, the weather gets rough, not a lot of sunlight, you miss the beach, which I never actually
what
saw this
beach?
Year.
There's no beaches around here.
Well, you travel to beaches. I didn't.
Where?
Not in here.
This is Alberta.
Yeah.
Saskatchewan.
There's some
Where
beaches.
Are there beaches in Saskatchewan?
By the lakes. Anyway, point being is that we miss all that stuff in the winter. And what helps us get through it is the sports season, at least for many of us. So hockey, basketball, other things as well. And I'm just very happy and excited that the TV's flooded with that now going forward.
Yeah. Well, there's lots of stuff on.
Yeah. I'm just very happy that it's back. Now, can I go negative?
Yes. Yeah. Please okay. Do.
So you talked about, you know, the
we're
fact
not a negative show, really.
Well, okay, I guess I'm negative apparently. So you mentioned earlier about sample size. I think that's what 8 times I've said that on the show now. And I'm going to now go a little bit off what I was doing and just get mad at everyone that's been going off of one period sample size. So after the Oilers game, admittedly, I love McDavid too. Every single Oilers fan is going, Cup now, 16-0. Every Sportsnet analyst was saying how the Oilers are the team to beat after one game. One game,
sounds
folks.
Sounds a lot like Leaf fans.
The Warriors, the Leafs certainly similar. The Warriors also lose their first preseason game. They lost their first preseason game. It's the leading story on ESPN. I thought people would have learned it last year after the Warriors lost their opening season game, went on to win the regular season title, and then went on to smoke everyone in the postseason, including the Cleveland Cavaliers. Guys, one game sample size. That's what's bugging me.
One game sample size.
Sample size. I mean, at least into 20 now for the sample sizes.
Sample size.
Sample size.
Oh, my gosh. Sample size. Okay, so.
Okay, your turn.
Yeah, this doesn't only bug me. I know this bugs plenty of people who watch sports. And what bugs me is when officials take over games. Look, nobody pays their hard-earned money. Nobody comes out to watch sporting events to watch officials.
Nope.
Nobody. Put your whistles away. Put your flags away. Put everything away, unless it's absolutely necessary. Just stop with all the penalties. Nobody cares. Nobody's there to watch you. Nobody's watching you to skate down the ice and make slashing calls or cross-checking calls like you're a top dog. Nobody cares. Nobody wants to listen to you call football penalties. Nobody. Just stop doing it. Let people play the game they're there to play. Stop interfering and slowing it down. It sucks. That's what's bugging me.
Short of preventing mass murder, I don't want to see an official do anything in a game.
No. Just I mean, I don't have a problem. Look, officials are there for a reason. I get it, right?
Yeah. But preventing mass murder.
A lot of times, officials create more animosity between teams because of the way they look after games.
Yeah.
And they just, it's almost like they want to be the focal point of the game. Nobody's there to watch you. Nobody.
Nope. If I wanted to watch a zebra, I'd go to the petting zoo.
Yeah, for sure.
There's a very beautiful zebra there that's actually interesting to look at.
That you know, if that's the case, then for the beginning of hockey games, as an example, just the officials come out and that's it. Don't bring the teams out because everyone's there to see the officials, right?
Yeah.
I mean, just have them skate around. Well, it'd be like when Garrett's here, it'd be like, Garrett asks us questions.
Yeah.
That'd be the same thing. Garrett, you ask us questions because we're the focal point.
But like, see, that could have been really funny, though.
That actually could
have. Like, that actually would have some entertainment value.
That would.
Because
but nobody's there to watch us, so there's no entertainment.
Because if he asked me the wrong question, I would get really awkward.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, nobody's watching us, though, right?
No.
Nobody. So just stop doing it.
No, but actually do watch us when we're on the show. I mean, like, dude, please watch us.
We'd like you to watch us. Sure. Yeah. That's part of it.
Yeah.
So 7 days, we're back. Yep. Josh Ryan will be back. You won't be back.
No, I'm out.
You're not here next week.
I have to go on a trip. I'll be back the week after.
Kira Lyons, be back on next week.
She classes up the joint anyway. So.
She does class up the joint a little bit. So thanks for watching.
Yeah.